I'm offering is the truth, nothing more.
I'm a relationship hack.
Run up and get touched up, suicide. And all of y'all know my style. I excel, then prevail. Run up and get touched up, suicide, that's it. And all of y'all know my style.
Yeah!
Meet on this plane.
You just can't start it from the top. Just try to start it from the top. Whenever Jimmy Superfly Snuka is running the music, he always starts it in the middle. You don't have an iPod, do you? You don't have an iPhone? You don't have, you got cassettes? Yo! Welcome to the Zowa Morning Show. Hey, this album dropped October 7th. And I talked to the label guy. And I think it's doing pretty well. You don't understand how excited I am about this brother's work. And I've been getting a lot of feedback from Zowa listeners that's telling me they think it's fire. I already told you. You know, I did A&R for about 10 years. And I know what it's supposed to sound like. And this album is fire. Now, Joseph Lineberg, he like a brother. I've known him for years. You know, since high school. And, you know, he's an artist. You know how artists be kind of weird?
Yep.
You know, he's a strange kind of dude. Yeah, a little off-center. But even though I ride with him 100%, and he put together this album, man. Y'all better go get it right now. It's on iTunes. Astral Progressions by Joseph Lineberg. I love it. Hey, play one more. Let me hear the what's the first joint? The very first joint. Let's just hear it real quick. Like, let me just say, I know this sounds weird, but when I'm typing and working on my book, the latest book, The Holographic Relationship, I'll be in like another space, like some weird Alfred Hitchcock type shit. Yo, you gotta support Astral Progressions by my good friend Joseph Lineberg. Or you could turn it down now. Just let it ride in the background as I promote these businesses. Listen, business number one, I gotta do this. Today, I need a strong showing. I say this every week because every week is kind of quiet on the GoFundMe side of the game. We're trying to do something amazing here. We're trying to take what we have, the Zowa Morning Show, the Voice of Reason, and other shows. We're gonna try to get Jeff Brown's, you know, get him a show. We're gonna try to get Bobby, Real Men Don't Play. We're trying to get everybody a show under the banner and power of our own network. Pull up my GoFundMe page right now, the birth of the VOR network. Listen, man, we need you guys to make a real push today. It's too many people watching this show for us to not do $5,000 today. $5,000 is not a lot when you have a global audience. Everybody kick up $25 today across the country who watch this show on YouTube, live. Kick up $25. Let's get it done. The last donation we got was what? About?
That's lunch.
What was it? About 2 hours ago. Hey, man. We need to do this. Our own voice. Our own network. Let's get active. All right. So now that that's out of the way, don't forget to get the relationship dismount. We only have 165 copies of these left. The physical copies. Of course, you can get it at iTunes, iBooks, Kindle if you want the digital copy, but the physical copy you get directly from me. You see my website on the screen right now, iamzowilliams.com. If you order it today, I'll mail it out tomorrow. Oh, also, Privy Point. Pull this website up. This is the Business Swiss Army Knife app. This business, turn my man Joe down just a little bit. Because it ain't quite Halloween. But this is the Business Swiss Army Knife app. Search, share, events, buy, discover, market, sell. If you have a business, your business would benefit by downloading this right now. Let's mass download the Privy Point app. Work with it, and I want to hear your feedback. You guys tell me what you think about it. It's on Google Play as well as the App Store. Get it now. Privy Point. Look at the features. You can share stuff. You can buy stuff. You can discover stuff. You could set alerts. You could market your own products. You can search for things. There's events. All of that is contained within this app. This is the Business Swiss Army Knife. Everything you need to get your business seen or to look for businesses, you could do it right there. Go get it right now. Privy Point is the app. Let's mass download this mug right now.
No.
Wee Juice is in the building, ladies and gentlemen. This brother brings free juices to us all the time. And I love the fact that you guys continue to support his business endeavor. Order your juices now. Anybody can have some of these. What do we have here? Cool water. Oh, man, I love this music. Pineapple Sunset. Baby, I'm a Star. What is this? White Grape, Strawberry, and Blueberry. Ah, you want this? There you go, Doc. I'm going to take this turmeric shot. Hey, listen. That's Wee Juice. Did you guys pull up the website? There we go. Yeah. Hassan McCullough out of Pasadena, California. The brother is a fitness trainer and a juicer. Hey, support the movement. That's what it is. If you're not supporting the movement, you're in the way of the movement. Hey, how about that? All right, let's see what else we got here. We've got Just Listen and Talking to Crazy. Dr. Mark Goulston, the only white man who is allowed to come in here and speak on things with us. All of the white men have been banished from the round table. Here you go, Dr. G. Hey, continue to support Dr. G. What else we got? Shepherd Family Suites and then Booty Boxing. Pull up Shepherd Family Suites. Let me tell you something. I keep saying Shepherd Family Suites. It's Shepherd's Suites.
Shepherd's.
Let me tell you what's crazy about this right now. In the car, because I got a shout out to my great uncle, my great grandmother's son, oldest son, James Jr. McWhorter. James McWhorter Jr. He passed last week and his funeral is today. So after the show, I got to zip over to Pasadena and, bid farewell to my great uncle. He gave cousins and nephews jobs and shit. This is what I love about my family. My great uncles name all of their businesses after their mama. After Big Mama. You go to Pasadena, we got Big Mama's Rib Shack. And her 90-something or 80-something-year-old son is in there like, hey, boy, what's happening? Got Big Mama on the cover, on the menu, smiling and shit. I'm like, yeah, okay, Big Mama. You hungry, boy? Want some fried okra?
That's it.
I got you. So my great-uncle who passed, he had Big Mama's used furniture. This motherfucker was a Fred Sanford.
Big Mama's used furniture.
But he was very successful. And what was interesting, I remember him as a child. Whenever a stove broke down or a refrigerator broke down, my mom would get on the phone and call Uncle Jimmy. James. Uncle James, we need a refrigerator. He roll over with the truck. Okay, got a refrigerator right here. He basically knew.
That's dope.
And he put it in the house, and we good. So when you have family, supporting each other, like, my mother never paid for anything. He just bring it, And that's what I remember about him. He was always giving. So we're going to wish farewell to Uncle Jimmy. I got love for you, Uncle Jimmy, and I'm going to go commune with the family today. Shepherd Suites provided a huge sweet potato cake. It's in the car.
That's not fair.
I'll be right back.
Hey, let me tell you. Can I tell you? I went over there the other day. You know what she made? She was like, I'm going to put this on the menu. I said, well, what'd you put on the menu? A ginger carrot spice cake. I think she's putting Schedule One drugs in it.
It damn well be
it's
true,
it's just
man.
Really God retarded. Damn. It's just really it's ignorant ridiculous. How delicious it is. ShepherdSweets.com is at the website. Please get over there and do it. Go support the businesses right now. Kevin, even though you left me hanging.
I left you hanging.
Yeah.
I left you hanging.
It's cool. I mean, you know, get your money, pimp.
Who left me hanging the week before?
That's fine. It's fine.
Yeah, sure.
We're not talking
show
about
him. Show him the shirt, man.
Hey, Kevin got new shirts, man. Phoenix Mall.
We got the Phoenix Mall shirts. We got the All Rights Reserve shirts. That's this right here. And the Dragon Moore shirts, as he has over there.
This is the shirt I'll be wearing today.
And this is the Native Amarukan shirt.
Native Amarukan shirt, okay.
And then we also have the Without Prejudice shirt.
Without
Whoa,
prejudice.
What size is that one?
Without prejudice.
They don't make them small.
Yeah, they
too
make
small
them small enough for me.
So, yeah, go to realnagas.com. We got the Phoenix Moore, Dragon Moore shirts, everything. Also, the status classes, they've been going strong for about a month now. They're on Wednesdays and Thursdays. Also, we have recorded classes, so if you missed them, you can just order the recorded classes, and I'll hook you up with that. So that's at realnagas, realnagas.com.
Yo, what else business? You got a business? Come on, Timmy Tight Top. What we doing?
What's up, fam?
You got a business to promote really quickly?
Real quick, yeah. My joint's called... How We Stay Ready. It's a style of training, but also encompasses a bag. It's like a knapsack.
I don't have it.
Tell
us. I didn't know you were going that way.
Knapsack right here. I wear it as a backpack, but it also turns into a training bag. You can do squats, deadlifts, turns into a kettle. I call it a kettle bag.
Really?
Every training movement you do inside a gym, you can do, or inside a gym, you do outside. Fill this with 120 pounds of sand.
Really? So it could be a punching bag, too.
It can be a punching bag. You know what I mean? I throw it. You know, do everything I do with this thing.
This dude is a genius.
And it's also a backpack.
Word.
Your website, you can.
Yeah.
The website is called howwestayready.com or T3 Stay Ready.
Wow.
It comes up.
You have a video there, don't you? Do you have a video?
Yeah, there's a video there as well. Yeah. It comes like this. Small, compact.
How much does it cost?
Small bag is $80.
Mm-hmm.
Medium bag is $100.
That's fair.
And the big bag is $130.
And it turns into a training bag.
Exactly.
Wow. Well,
it's waterproof, leak-proof,
sandproof. Leak-proof. It is waterproof. There will be a water bladder coming that you can get with it.
Wow.
Well. So, in terms of a backpack, so if you want to use these straps
there
right
is,
here.
There is up there on the screen, yeah.
This is it right here, the website?
Yes, sir. My website is all about wellness. It's all about the physical fitness part for me and most people. It's pretty simple, but I think the biggest thing is the wellness, man, the spiritual side, the emotional side, the intellectual side.
Excellent, man. Sounds excellent.
Hey, thanks, man.
Let's keep it cracking. Hey, listen, I got one more to promote.
Thank you.
Power in One Clothing. Let me just say Power in One Clothing stepped up this morning and made a donation of $100 to the VOR Radio Network project we're trying to manifest here. And I just want to say this is one of the few businesses that support what Zoe does with money. Right? With money. Now, they know Zoe's been, you know, helping them get their brand out worldwide. But what they said was, Zoe, we're not going to pay you with our T-shirts. We're not going to just send you T-shirts to wear, which benefits us, because people see you in the T-shirt, and then they say, where'd you get the T-shirt? And then you tell them where you got the T-shirt, and then they come spend money with us. You know, they said, no, we're going to give you money for all the work that you've done. And the brother sent me a heartfelt email. His name is Omar, I think. On Facebook, heartfelt email saying, thank you for helping us reach our fifth year in business. So Power in One Clothing, I just wanted to say thank you for having a durable brand that people like, that people support. Unfortunately, I'm not wearing one of their shirts today, but it's another company that I support, RBG Tees, as well. But I just wanted to send a personal shout out to Power in One Clothing and to say thank you for your star-worth support of the Zo What Morning Show. Listen, that's the end of the community empowerment. We're about to take a quick break. When we come back, we're going to set up the topic. But I'm telling you now, download my app, Google Play, iTunes, Zo Williams, no spaces. Download the app. Support the VOR Radio Network on GoFundMe. And get your copy of The Relationship Dismount from IamZoWilliams.com. Only 65 copies remaining. Get there now. When we return, today's topic, nuts. We'll be back in 2.2. Zo What Morning, Zena.tv. Deuces.
Did you know that 67% of American women are size 14 and above?
You mean they look like this?
Yeah, girl.
So then where are we in television and film?
And where are we in fashion magazines and clothing stores?
Yeah.
So we want to help out entertainment and fashion and media.
Catch the F up.
Watch us on Plus This.
Live.
Every Thursday
at 7 p.m.
on Zena TV.
Jason Stewart here for Zena TV. On the show Absolutely Jason Stewart every Wednesday at 1 p.m. Big guests, everyone from the gayest to gay to the straightest to straight. David, what was his name?
He's absolutely Jason. He's absolutely gay. He'll absolutely brighten up.
I start. Hi, I'm Moxie.
And I'm Nicole. And we're the ladies of Suicide Girls Radio, the world's leading BYOB radio show. Pour a glass of your favorite tipple and tune in on Wednesday nights between 8 and 9 p.m. as we discuss life, liberty, and the pursuit of free nipples.
Oh, just flash it would be kind of funny, wouldn't it?
People think flashing your tits is easy, right? And it's actually kind of hard.
Hey, we were supposed to be going right to Dr. G's toolbox, but I like the music. Thor be fucking up all the time, I promise you. I'm telling you, Thor high.
I'm smoking weed before you come here.
Thor come in here high than a motherfucker, boy.
Like, what's happening, Sam? Yeah, man, rock on.
Oh, here we go. White guy like me co-hosting a black radio show. I think toxic relationships cause you to take poor care of yourself. That if you can recognize danger, if you can pause, if you can take some breaths, refocus, and engage, you might be able to dodge a bullet that you're going to send or coming towards you. One of the things that men don't get is that often women need to vent first to clear their mind.
That is the whitest intro ever. We had to do it because you're probably the whitest man we've ever allowed.
Hey, don't screw with your token diversity. You know. Anyway.
You are white, though. Don't ever forget that.
I am white, and if that's not enough, I'm Jewish.
He's not white, and you're not black.
You can beat me up on a lot of things. Anyway, our promise today for the show is it's not contagious. And by that I mean what we're going to be talking about is a serious topic, and the topic is homelessness. And one of the reasons people avoid homeless people is because they think their hopelessness, helplessness, and powerlessness is contagious. And they will, and many people think there, but for the grace of God, will go me. And I think the homelessness represent our conscience. Winston Churchill once said something that the measure of a civilization is how it treats people who hurt it. I would add to that, it's the measure of a civilization is how it treats people who are hurting in it. A final thing, I'm a neuroscientist, so I can't resist that. I think one of the reasons we avoid homelessness from a neuroscience point of view is there's chemicals in our head, and three of them are called dopamine, adrenaline, and testosterone. Dopamine gives you pleasure. Adrenaline, testosterone gives you power, and you hang out with people who have the that same kind of thing, and you get a contact high off each other. Well, when you're around homeless people, it kind of causes you to crash off those if you have any compassion. And if you don't have compassion, you just get nervous and you just get away from them. And therein lies one of the central problems of humanity. So we're going to address that today, and looking forward to this. And if anyone's viewing in who's maybe homeless but can listen to the show, I hope you'll find some hope and some answers and some understanding.
Well, Dr. G has set us up effectively, properly today, but I like to go ham. Let me just tell you, today's topic, the saga of a sick society continues. A deeper look into the rise of homelessness, depression, domestic violence, and mental illness amongst our nation's forgotten veterans. A lot of homeless people are veterans. The shit that fucking kill me is how, let me just say, America is one of the most hypocritical fucking countries in the world.
Full of shit.
Oh my God, Kaepernick, you're disrespecting our servicemen. But at the same time, you turn your fucking back when they homeless.
Yep.
You've used up all your credits here. I don't know what else to tell you. Thank you for your service. You salute the shit out of you on your way out the door. This shit is fucked up.
What's wrong with you, man?
Right? Maybe. They won't deal with the issue. Cap is disrespectful. Terry Bradshaw, he's going to get what's coming to him for disrespecting the flag. Where you at? Are you buying people homes?
Thank you.
Who can't? Are you feeding the veterans? He might. He might be. But how come your criticism of Kaepernick has a larger impact in the public sphere than the work you're doing for the veterans? Now, the veterans are one section of society who's affected by homelessness. What about them kids that are homeless? Right? What about the women that are homeless? And if you start looking at the research, there are black men out there in great numbers that are homeless too, right? When we start talking about the brothers that are on the street, it rivals the brothers that are in prison. When we start talking about the numbers, the statistics, everybody got something to say about how you become homeless. There's motherfuckers out there on the street with degrees. That's geniuses.
Right. Oh,
yeah. Right? But America thinks if you homeless, here's the stereotype, you lazy, you uneducated, right? You just didn't want to do nothing for yourself. And the homeless get the same knock on the head as black men. You're just lazy. Pull yourself up by your bootstraps. Right? Just get your shit together. Why would you ever want to be out here on the street? What? They don't understand the circumstances around homelessness. We don't even want to talk about the financial collapse of 2008
Thank you.
That took a lot of middle class people and who were doing pretty
homeless.
Good.
And made them homeless.
Motherfuckers was all right, right?
Or suicidal.
Hey, yep. How about that? Or mental illness.
Yeah. Yep.
A lot of black people don't want to talk about mental illness in our community. You know how we'll hide away that fucking molester? Mm. He's still at motherfucking Thanksgiving. Nobody wants to talk about him. But this shit is real on the streets. We got somebody in studio who's not just going to talk about it from a superficial, you know, observational space. We got somebody on the show that's going to talk about it from an experiential space. The brother's name is Thomas Andrews. And let me just, we gave him a name too. Our name for him here, because he's now family, our name for him here is Timmy Tight Top. He fills the shirt out, and Timmy Tight Top is what we gonna refer to him as. Everybody get a nickname up in this month. I'm Slant Hill. Everybody get a nickname.
Slant Hill, man.
But let me say this really quickly. The brother just donated to the VOR Radio Network sitting right here. He heard about it. He acted on it. He sent $25. Let me just say thank you from the bottom of my heart, brother. I appreciate you for doing that. We got to be people of action nowadays if we want to clean up this broken society. Without further ado, let me welcome this brother formally, Thomas Andrews. Talk to us about your experience out here on the street, man, and how you were able to get out of this situation and some of the stereotypes and cold looks and all the bullshit you had to deal with while you were fighting your way out of that situation. Talk to me.
Oh, wow, man. It's first of all, thanks for letting me be here today, man. To talk about this is tough sometimes, you know what I mean? Because, you know, at 54 years of age, you don't see this happening. You don't picture this happening. I lived in Bali for 3.5 years, in Indonesia for a year. So I had a really nice place in Bali, and I had some people who loved me and took care of me. But on this journey of life, man, I knew that I had to do certain things, and I knew I had to design a product that I had to bring back to America, and I knew I had to get back into the race of life, you know, because I've done some things which hurt a lot of people, so I was carrying around that baggage.
Mm-hmm.
And it's that psychological trauma that really, that weighs heavy, and it took me in some deep spots. So coming back here, man, I thought I was going to be like the prodigal son in the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? You know, folks going to welcome me home, you know, we go blah, blah, we're going to do this, we'll kick it. But I stopped drinking, and I stopped, you know, smoking weed, and I stopped doing a lot of the things, man, that damaged me, and I had lost all those friends. So I'm basically back in L.A. starting from scratch, and where I damaged a lot of people. So
wow.
Luckily, my homeboys gave me a car.
Wow.
And that was my house, was my car. You know, my story has been, you know, I smelled a lot, you know what I mean? I didn't have a place to clean myself up, you know. I didn't have I had people look at me, like, sideways, man. And, you know, it didn't feel good knowing that I had some nice stuff before, you know. And,
wow.
You know, security guards, man, coming at you and pushing you out of the way, telling you can't park here, get your car out of here. And,
wow.
You know, where do I park my car to sleep at night? You know what I mean? And you know, where do I use the bathroom? It's just the stuff that.
No, I feel you, man. It's I was homeless too.
That's what's up.
For about a little over a month, and I did the same thing. I'm staying in my car, and it helps you to see a different perspective of homeless people, because the way I got homeless was because I was trying to help a lot of people, and I had a. You know, some property, sold my property, got a lot of money. So I was trying to help all the homies. And, but.
I remember you had that house.
Mm-hmm.
I did a lecture at your house.
Yep. And so, you know, trying to help all the homies, you know, who didn't have money, who, you know, didn't have any jobs. So I'm feeding brothers and they stand with me. Nobody's paying rent. So then the money runs out.
You MC Hammered yourself?
Man. Straight up. Straight up with the Bontourage. And
the Bontourage.
and so but when that happened, when the money ran out, everybody had bounced. And so I just didn't have no place to stay. So I just slept on the car. I'd move the car everywhere, stay outside of LA Fitness, and then go in LA Fitness, take a shower, because I knew some people who worked there. So I would just go there real early in the morning before they opened.
Yeah.
They let me come in and take a shower. And so it just helped me to start to see that, when people are on the street, you have no idea what their story is. And, mm-hmm. A lot of people are always, they diss homeless people. And they have these misconceptions that, as Zoe was saying earlier, that everyone is lazy. I mean, you have no idea what put this person into that position. So,
and black people got to be the last people to judge.
Yeah.
Because when you look at the 1% versus the 99%, how many black people are on the other side in the 1%?
Three.
Like one or two, like four people. Uh-huh. So the majority of our people, regardless of what we look like, because there's a lot of flossers out there.
That's right.
That are on the 99% trying to financially shame somebody else. Yeah. Like, do you know how close you are to being homeless yourself?
If you miss next week's check.
Yeah.
You hand to mouth right now.
Yep.
With no unified community to catch you when you fall.
Structure. No structure.
How many motherfuckers in the African American community gotta hustle and scrape some shit together when somebody die? Because they ain't got the family collectively don't have the bread
to pay the
funeral costs. Mm-hmm. Don't act like it ain't some nigga. We good over here, okay? Come on.
Yeah. Or, man. In our situation, my father just died in October when I came back from Bali. He had money, but in our family we got drug addiction is huge. So I had a couple of brothers that my father took care of. So when it was time for my father suddenly died, the wealth that the money he had put together for his own benefit, my brothers had kind of, smoked it, so.
Smoked it.
Wow. Yeah. Damn. So, we're scrambling money, to bury my dad,
Damn.
Well, go ahead, Doc.
Yeah, I got a question, because I've never been homeless.
Of course not. What the fuck? Shit.
You have a community to help.
That's right. No,
what? Dr. G is homeless? but
I'd like a piece of this action because I'd like, a lot of people talk about bottoming out. So I have bottomed out. And I was, and if it wasn't for the act of someone who stepped in and saw a future for me that I didn't see, and saw a purpose for me that I didn't see, and saw some goodness without having to prove it that I didn't
Ooh-wee.
See. And that's part of why I do what I do. And what I do is I gotta pay it forward. So it doesn't hold a candle to what you guys have survived. But talk a little bit about the idea of bottoming out, because a lot of people are flirting with bottoming out. And if you can just spend a little time about how you turned a corner, what went on in your head, was there some friend, someone who gave you that car? Because there's a lot of people that are just a hair away from that, and they're afraid that they'll never make it back. So if you can talk about bottoming out, if you can relate to that or use your own term, I'd really like to hear about that.
You want to answer first?
You go ahead, bro.
Well, the bottoming out, for me, was just realizing that the group or the, who I considered, really like a lot of, my brothers and close homies, when the money ran out, they was all there when I'm all around and I'm buying food and I got this nice luxury apartment downtown. Everybody's chilling, but nobody's paying rent. And so then it runs out and you start to ask, okay, can I get some help now? And then it's like, oh, brother, man, damn.
You was the help.
Exactly. That's how that's exactly how that went. And so I'm like, so, you know, the bottoming out, you know, then it's, you know, there's no place for you. You know, you can't stay on the couch. Oh, man, damn, I can't really do it this time, because a lot of the homies had girlfriends, and then that would mess up. You know, they didn't want to mess up their relationship with the girlfriend and stuff like that.
Did you feel any betrayal at all, or just disappointment in them?
Well, when I had my places, yeah, I mean, I let a lot of people stay there. So, you know, the fact that, and betrayal maybe by a couple of people who had means, but for the most part, the people who were staying with me, they couldn't afford shit either. So, I mean, I didn't feel betrayal as far as them not helping me, but the fact that they didn't take the help that I gave them and make something out of it. And so when you have a community like that, if everyone is destitute in that community, you're going to be fucked off.
Wow.
So, you know, if you're going to have a site or a community of people, you guys, somebody has to be doing something. All of you should be doing something, just in case. So when one person falls off, then the other people within that community can help lift that person up. And see, Jews understand this. But melanated people have no idea what the hell's going on.
Well, let's throw the question back to Doc, because Doc liked to question motherfuckers without answering questions himself. What's the Jewish homeless population?
Pretty small, pretty small.
I know, like seven motherfuckers. Because <okay? laughs> they won't accept the help.
Okay, and they only on vacation.
Right?
No, they'll invest back in it. There's all kinds of Jewish charities that they throw money right into. They won't let someone fall through the cracks. Yeah.
That's what I'm talking about.
Hey, we'll be right back, because that's some big shit that need to get dealt with.
Damn.
Listen, let me just ask this question before we go real quick. Can you give to homeless people without judging? It's a judgment call when you say, I'm not going to give them money because I don't want them to go buy drugs.
Sometimes you got to make that call.
But that's a judgment. Hear what I'm saying? It's a judgment call.
It is.
But it doesn't have a clarity, though. And I'll tell you why. Your beliefs about drugs prevent you from giving them money so they can get drugs. What if drugs are the only bliss they feel? What if they need the numbness to get through the day? Who are you to judge that? Well, I'd rather buy you something to eat. Well, a burrito is not going to make me feel like the endo will make me feel. Do you understand what I'm saying? Yeah, sometimes the drug is the numbing sedative to get them through that. And it's not on us to judge them. What do you think about that, ladies and gentlemen? When we come back, we're going to deal with that question right there. Zena.tv. Zo, what morning show? We're taking a quick break. We'll be back at 2.2. Thor, play it at the top.
You have an amazing Lemmy story for me?
An amazing one? Everything he does is amazing. The guy puts snarl in the metal. Come on.
Big heart. Love that guy.
That guy was the real deal in every way.
Lemmy was just a class act.
So thank you, Lemmy.
No way I was gonna miss tonight's tribute to the Lemmeister, man.
Let's hear for Lemmy! Scream for Lemmy! Can you feel the energy in the room? Lemmy lives on!
God bless Lemmy, and he will live on through all of us.
To the spirit and memory of Lemmy! Long live Lemmy, my brothers and sisters!
Yo, how many of you motherfuckers got homeless family members? Listen, money, capitalism, has fractured us to such a degree that even a family member will look like an interloper on your wallet. Be like, I can't help. You peeing. It's a motherfucker you shared a bunk bed with when you was little. You be like,
sorry, homie.
My nigga.
Sorry, like, just,
I can't even give you the porch right now. You feel me? Money has contaminated every aspect of our lives.
Yes, it has.
And we will fucking money shame a dude with a job. So you know we'll money shame a motherfucker that ain't got a four walls. Look at this motherfucker. You understand what I'm saying? So then, in the act of giving, you're like, I ain't going to give to you if you're going to smoke some weed or some crack. Why? You don't know what they've been through? Crack? No disrespect. I'm just posing a question. I would love opposite opinions. Mm-hmm. Crack might be the closest friend they got. Is it on us to judge them for that? Kevin! Judgmental nigga. No, go ahead, Kevin. Go ahead, Kevin.
Well, for me, you know, I give quite a bit when I see homeless people. And then in doing so, you kind of get savvy about who you're giving to.
Right.
And so you can tell, you know, who's really out there and they're destitute and they really need the help, whereas somebody's out there hustling. Especially if you come back every other day and that person is still there all the time. So then to me, I'm like, okay, if you can do that every day, you can get a job. If you can be somewhere the same time every day asking for money doing this, that's pretty much like a job.
Yeah.
So you can go out and get you can go out and get yourself a job. So when I give to them, though, I always, because I don't want my money, I don't want to be an enabler for them to be get drugs. So I always let them know right off the hand, if I give them money, don't buy drugs with it. So,
okay.
But, that's right. But look.
Sure.
But look. Yeah. But, hey, look, if you buy drugs with it, after I'm clearing my karma. I'm clearing my energy out of the universe.
What you going to do? You going to follow them?
Huh?
You gonna follow him, Kevin?
No, I don't. Look,
I can see you following the homeless person.
After you buy drugs with it, after I give you money, then that's on you. But I told you not to buy drugs. My karma's clear. Now, I had an incident when I used to live with a couple of homies. We were asleep one night, and at 3 o'clock in the morning, we got a bang on the door with somebody screaming, "No, no, no!" So we were like, "What the fuck?" We jumped up, opened the door, and it was this homeless guy with dreadlocks, and he was just screaming, "No, no!" So he's like, "Dude, you need to get up out of here. We trying to sleep," and I had to get up and go to work at 6 a.m. So we sent him away. About 15, 20 minutes later, he comes back banging on the door, "No, no!" Now, we lived in the very last apartment in the building on the top floor at the end of the hall. So he had to pass every other apartment in the whole building just to get to our apartment. Mm. So the second time when he came up, I was getting mad because I had to get up. So one of my roommates got him and says, "Look, I'll handle it." He walked him outside, and then he didn't come back for about 20, 30 minutes. So my other roommate was like, "Well, I'm about to go check on him to make sure he all right." He leaves. He didn't come back for another 20 minutes. I'm like, "Oh, shit. This dude done killed him." So I jump up, and I'm getting ready to go outside. They come back in. They're like, "No, dude, this guy's real cool, man." It's like, you got some rolling papers or something? I was like, "Dude, I don't have no rolling papers. He about to smoke weed with us and everything. He's so cool." So I'm like, "All right, just to keep him outside." 20 minutes later, they bring him upstairs. He's coming into the house. I'm like, "Are you bringing him into the house?" Like, so I'm tripping right now. It's like 4 a.m, 5 a.m. I'm like, "You bringing him motherfucking the house?"
It's like PETA. It's like PETA for humans.
Dude,
so, bring this stray dude in.
Right. So this crazy motherfucker who's knocking on our door screaming, "No, no." So when he gets to the door, he finally walks to the door and he says, he walks up to me and says, "Hi, how are you? I am Lewis." I'm like, "Are you the crazy motherfucker who was just screaming like an hour ago at my door?" So he's talking so calm, Lewis. So articulate. I mean, it was a total change. So come to find out that this dude had been to Tibet. He was a Tibetan priest trained in astrology. Mm-hmm. So when he had got there, this is when I was trying to learn astrology. And as Zoe know, we really into that. So this was my introduction into it. He came there and he literally started to break down astrologically everybody in the room. So I was like, "This shit is crazy." The next day, we invited 15 people over the house. He started killing everybody without knowing a name, not knowing anything, gathering their signs, how they acted, how the relationships interacted, everything. This dude was ill. And so it just let me know. I'm like, "Man, you have no idea what these people know out there." This dude has been.
Hold on, though. You still ain't addressed why this nigga's outside yelling no. Because that's going to turn me off.
Again. Well,
I don't give a fuck what you know, nigga. You was out here yelling just a second ago. What's happening?
Motherfucker was a crackhead. So when he smoked crack, it was like, to me, his higher consciousness was telling him not to do it. And so whenever he did that, so for 4 days, he was chilling at our house, just kicking it, no smoking anything, just breaking off all the knowledge he had acquired when he was over in Tibet. So one of my roommates was secretly smoking crack, and he wasn't spiritual. So we
That's
leave.
Why one of your roommates let his ass in.
Mm-hmm. So, again, yeah. So I come home from work one day, and I hear, I'm down the hall, and I hear, "No, no."
Again.
Screaming. Yeah, and I'm motherfuckers in the house now. So I get to the house, and he's in there just screaming, "No."
Wait, hold on. This motherfucker's a roommate now?
Dude, that wasn't my place, so I didn't have no say-so.
This shit
so
didn't turn
the
bad.
The dude who was secretly smoking crack, though, it was his spot, and so he had let him stay there. So I didn't know he was smoking crack at the time. So when I get in there, he's screaming, "No, no." I'm like, and I asked the guy, I said, "What's wrong with him?" He goes, "I don't know."
He's seeing shit, ain't he?
He's, I don't know.
Some interdimensional shit going on.
So I slam, I just slam him up against the wall. I tell him to calm down, that he wasn't sent here for that. And literally, he calmed down. He looked at the other guy. He said, "Why? Why did you do that?" I'm like, "What? What the fuck did he do?" He's like, "Why did you buy this for me?" This motherfucker went and bought him some crack. Because as this dude, we were all in there. We were communing and talking about knowledge. The other guy, he was left out. He was a total, his vibration was so low that he just couldn't deal with that energy. He went out and bought the guy some crack to fuck him up on purpose. And so while he's in there, he smoked the crack. He tripped out again. So I told him that if he wanted to stay, he had to leave the crack alone. He had to throw the crack out. He refused. He's like, "No, I need to smoke this now."
Me and crack been around a long time.
You got the bounce stand, homie, and that was the last time I saw him. But just the information, the knowledge that I got from him has lasted me for 20 years.
Wow. Go ahead, bro.
What was the question?
Yeah, Kevin took us on an odyssey.
The drug thing. It was about the drugs.
Yes.
That's why I got on that.
Thanks for the odyssey, Kev.
You're welcome, bro. Any other time you want to go, let me know.
Buddy. Odyssey talk.
That's
yes.
Right.
Yeah. Go ahead, Thomas. What about the drug situation out on the streets? Pro, con?
I mean, it is what it is, man. Who am I to judge somebody and what they go through? I mean, that's their journey. You got to let people have their journey.
Mm-hmm.
And to speak on somebody's journey, I think, would be hypocritical.
Mm-hmm.
And it would be prideful. There's a lot of shit a lot of energies that are negative that stand in the way, man, of me reaching my full potential. Mm-hmm. So whatever you're going through, man, I'm going to give freely from my heart.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? And that's just the bottom line.
Mm. I love to hear that. Let me ask you this question. Say, like, if you're in a Fortune 500 environment, typically that environment, that mentality is sell, you know, let's make money. Let's, you know, there's a collective, you know, thought process of success and onward, upward. How would you describe the collective thought process of homelessness, people on the street? Despair, frustration, optimism, or the lack thereof? What? How would you frame it?
Family.
Ooh, see. No one would think that. No. Did you hear the man's answer? Say more.
It's family, man. They talk to each other. They back each other up. You know, they discipline each other. You know, they share. I saw them sharing soap and you know, toiletries and, you know, need a shirt. I saw them exchanging shoes the other day. Old dude's shoes was done.
Mm-hmm.
Another homeless dude, you know, like, you know, I got some shoes that might fit you. What's your size? So they exchanged shoes. When I go out there, I've been out there for the past 35 days working with homeless people, sharing with homeless people,
mm-hmm.
Because that's where I was, you know what I mean? So
you tell them what you do in the mornings.
Through Green Tree Yoga and Meditation on 83rd and Western, this, you know, nonprofit organization, the yoga center,
mm-hmm.
you know, black people practicing yoga in the hood, man, set up by a white lady, is cool as fuck, you know what I mean? So she made it so that I can get donations from Gelson's, Le Pain, Kuta Dane, sometimes Starbucks.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So when I'm out there in my car, I'm like, I need to be able to give back, I need to be able to share, mm-hmm. you know what I mean? Just because I'm in this position don't mean I can't share and show love to others,
mm-hmm.
you know what I mean? Because to me, to sit inside the shit is what is just worse, you know what I mean? If you're in it, you're in it. But I still have to do my job, Muhammad Ali called it service is the
yes.
rent that I pay.
Yes.
My spot on this earth.
Yes.
So I still got to be of service to mankind, and that's how I do it. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So I'd get up, you know, wake up in my car, go pick up the pastries, go get some water with my last $4 or $5, and I go share it with the homeless people.
Mm-hmm.
And from doing all that, I got a home. You know what I mean? I got a home from being of service to others.
Look at that.
So,
look at that.
You know, and I think about it, you know, it. And I learned family from these people.
Mm.
I learned people want to belong to something, you know what I mean? And that's all they got right now is a sense of belonging with each other. They get up in the morning, they go to the beach together, man.
Mm-hmm.
They go to the beach together. The homeless people, they go to the beach. They clean the area up,
mm-hmm.
you know what I mean? And then they go to the beach.
Let me just say how profound that story is. Because when I set the question up, I know the listeners was thinking, the mindset is depression.
Mm-hmm.
The mindset is angst. Not to say some of that doesn't exist down there, but he said the overall mindset down there is family. Yeah. You mean to tell me the majority of black people make up the 99%, regardless of what kind of job you hold, collectively, the majority of black people make up the 99% and homeless stronger sense of family than you do?
Sticking together.
God damn. Frightening thought, bruh. Let me introduce this brother really quickly. He came a little late. He was supposed to be a part of our community empowerment segment, but he's a part of the conversation, right? Brother, introduce yourself. Tell him what you do, and then contribute to the conversation that we're having at large here. Tell him what you do and what you're representing, because I know you got something powerful. Listen to this, everybody.
My name is Thomas T.J. Lofton. I am now a public speaker and facilitator of information. So I do a lot of coaching. I teach people about business, everything. Now I made a bunch of DVDs on international business, how to pick a good location to put your business. My background is the classic car industry. I just shipped a lot of lowriders overseas to Japan, Germany, et cetera. You know, I tapped into that market. So a lot of that unknown wealth that most people don't know anything about, the STEM program, science, technology, engineering, you know, welding, auto body classes, things like that. So I teach people. I go to the schools, talk to the young people saying, hey, we got to start welding. You can make 6 figures, 8 figures doing that. People don't know that. We sleeping on that. But to get back to your conversation, I was the president of the Leimert Park Vendors.
Uh-oh. Here we go.
Mr. Businessman Guru decided to go down to the park to think, let me go help my people. Let me go teach them business or something. I go up to Leimert Park and end up getting taught. Why is that? We got a high homeless population there. So I'm sitting there all day with my little pop-up table, and I'm like, how did this cat go homeless? Let me ask him. I'm bored as heck.
How did
you go homeless?
Right.
And then the dude, he starts talking, and like you said, he's brilliant. I'm like, you used to do what?
I'm a theoretical physicist.
What are you doing here? Oh, well, you know, I used to work at Sony, and I was the director of whatever, 6+ figures a year. And all of a sudden, I came home, and my wife was cheating on me. And I divorced her and took her to court. You know, I had the big house up in Malibu and blah, blah, blah. And they gave her everything. And it wasn't my fault.
People don't even talk about the divorce side of the game that'll lead you to homelessness.
Yeah, so the brother said, the court system said, I got to give her this, give her the house, and I owe her my pension. So my way of getting back at her is I'm just going to go homeless. And she can't get anything because I have to sign off. And I'm sitting there like,
wow.
Whoa.
I'm going to go live on the street just so you just don't get to eat off my shit.
Because you can't, if I don't file for my unemployment or my retirement, you can't get it.
There you go.
If I can't get it, you ain't gonna get it.
And I'm sitting there.
That's classic Richard Pryor. You ain't told none of these jokes. You ain't made air record. You ain't getting none of this. Go ahead, bro.
So it just became the hobby to, what happened to you? Well, what you doing here? You know, who can I help get out of here? Who got an easy solution? It's like, well, my wife used to take care of me. I used to work for Marla Gibbs at the Vision Theater. And then all of a sudden, my wife died, my house fell apart, and then Marla lost the vision and let it go, and I went homeless. I didn't know what to do. Wow. My wife been taking care of me for the last 35 years.
Wow.
You know, I make the money, but I gave it to her, and she paid the bills. And I'm like, I thought about that. I said, I don't even like ironing my clothes because they've been happening for me, so I can relate to this story. You know, it was just so much stuff that happens to them. Another brother, we call him James Brown. Why are you in the park dressing like Hollywood? And he said, I'm thinking he's crazy running around here like that. Yeah, I was on American Idol and...
Wow.
Damn.
Hold on. We are in the age of technology. What's your name again?
Wow.
Damn. He's like, hey, bro, what's happening?
It just blew me away. Yeah, I was supposed to play James Brown in the movie, and...
Wow.
They blackballed me and arrested me so I wouldn't show up today for the interview. And everybody, J-Lo said I had the job. Such and such said I. And I'm sitting there looking at the video like, yeah, he stole the show. He looks like James Brown. He acts like James Brown. And it was just so many amazing stories like that. And that's what made me say, when they said, we're going to kick these vendors out of this park, all of these homeless people got to go. I'm like, no.
Wow.
We got some stories here. We're going to have to fight y'all for this. We're going to have to keep them here and figure this out, get them out the right way.
Wow. You see?
It's real, dude.
It can happen. Yeah. It can happen to anybody. From the highest to the middle to the lowest.
Yeah.
See, the one thing that we as black folk gotta learn how to do is this. I always say this. Stop judging other people by a standard that you didn't create. The people have been talking about the 13th.
That movie, the documentary.
The documentary by the good sister, Miss DuVernay, Ava DuVernay. If you've been following the Zo What Morning Show, we damn near 3 million views since we started the Zo What Morning Show. Over 20,000 subscribers on YouTube. We've covered every one of them topics.
Yep.
Every one. Privatized prisons, everyone, right? Mm-hmm. We covered all of that. Schedule I drugs.
Yep.
We covered all of these topics. We covered the 13th and 14th Amendment. We covered all of this. So when I see the sister who's in a position of power doing a documentary like that, see, that's a revolutionary move that typically black people are afraid to make.
Yep. Hmm.
She made that movie, and she called out at least 5-6 presidents.
Sure did.
Under your administration, under your administration, under your administration. And each time she called out an administration, she showed the number of inmates jump.
Yep.
And typically,
yep.
The inmates that jumped were African-American Latino.
Mm-hmm. Most of them under Bill Clinton.
Let me tell you why this is important. Yep. Let me tell you why this is important. Because we get into this society and we get a little taste of success and we somehow egoically get a sense of invulnerability, invincibility. My shit is straight. I'm good.
Right.
Let me tell you something. Every interaction in life not only has a social impact, but it's got a spiritual one too. The universe, the consciousness that all theoretical physicists are scratching their head about right now. Unified field theory. Oh, that shit is God. Everything emerges from the unified field where everything is one. Science is already there. So now, understand the spiritual stuff that Africans, that the ancient Indians, that the ancient Asians put together that was like, hey, there's some spiritual shit underneath all of this. That, do you understand what I'm saying? And what happens is you can be mercenary when it comes to getting your own shit. Acquisition, mine, me, my. But the spirit is going to put your ass in a position where you get thumped.
Yep.
Do you understand? The spirit is going to thump your ass and you're going to be like, well, fuck. I didn't do right by certain people. Sometimes it'll manifest itself not in loss, but in lacking. See, there's a difference between loss and lacking. Loss is something you've acquired and then lost. Lacking is something you ain't got because you haven't developed it. So you might get all this shit, acquire all this shit, and still be lacking empathy,
compassion, love,
understanding, love, and the universe will slap the shit out you when you're at the apex of everything you've acquired. This is why a lot of rich white people be like, what the fuck? Let me go meditate somewhere.
Yep.
I done conquered the world. Let me go find some
going
shit.
To spiritual retreats.
Let me get some meaning in my life.
Let me come back to spirit.
Right. How can you ignore a homeless person when the unified field theory says that everybody God?
Everybody.
Woo! Hold tight. Everything is God? Yeah. Consciousness. Everything is God. So when you see the dirt on them and all you can see is the dirt, then you've missed the opportunity for God to interact with itself. One portion of itself is at a particular level, which is an illusion. Another portion of itself is at another level, which is an illusion. So when you walk away egoically thinking you are better than them, as opposed to just being better off,
you've separated yourself.
Do you see that? Go deeper into that thought.
The ego has set in and you've separated yourself, which is by definition, that's what we are not. We are all the same. We are of the same element. Mm. So when that ego comes in, and I have to tell myself every day that's a battle because I deal in the physical world, you know, fitness. Mm-hmm. And what you see is what people look at quickly, look at the physicality of it. But in order for me to be where I am today, I had to reverse the way I look at this and had to understand it's not the physical. The physical, this is a meat sack. This is this is impermanence. It's going. It ain't going to be here. What I had to build was my spirit. I had to change the order of feeding and go from the inside out. Mm. How can I search for inspiration, or how can I be inspirational? Those are the two steps for me every day, man.
That's true.
People don't get it, man. Listen, make your point real quick because we got to take a quick break. Go ahead,
Chuck. Well, we'll come back because I was going to jump on what you was talking about, the community,
the
homeless people being community. But where I do my boot camp at the park, there's a certain section where we have to box because it's hard ground or concrete. And so I've been doing my boot camp there about 7 years, and periodically it gets taken over by homeless people. And so, you know, which for me, because I pay the park, I have to pay the park to do the boot camp there. So, you know, it kind of becomes a thing where, you know, I don't ever want to move them out of their space, you know, because I definitely understand their position because I've been in that spot too. But then, you know, for me, because I have to make my money so I don't get back to that place, then it becomes, you know, it's a balance. And so some people, they'll, you know, when other people do boot camps there, they'll go tell the office and try to move them out of there and stuff like that. But they don't talk to those people. See, when I get there, I talk to them. They're some of the coolest people ever. They get up there, they sweep. They do everything. I mean, they keep the place clean.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? They're, like you said, community. They're all interacting with each other. You need something from the store, they all tell. So one dude has a bike, so he's going around to the store. He's picking up everything for some people. Oh, you need this from over here? It's real ill, you know, how the community is. And so then they see me there every week, so it's kind of like I become a part of the thing. So every time they see, hey, brother, how you doing? Oh, man, you good? So, you know, we all communicate. And so you're right. Even though they're homeless, they have so much more than most people who have so many physical things.
Exactly.
They have that connection with each other, which you can't get, or which you can truly you can get, or would you understand by not having things? That's exactly. That's how you get that connection.
Yeah.
Wow. Listen, we got to take a quick break, man. This is a heavy fucking topic.
Let's peel this shit back.
But look, when we come back, we're gonna talk about the homeless hustlers.
Yeah, buddy.
Yeah, that shit real too. We done talked about God in the homeless. Now we got to talk about the fraud in the homeless. Because there are people out there that's pimping people, that's playing the sympathetic strings, you know? We got to talk about that shit when we come back, because you can't give it to everybody. Because somebody out there, them niggas know how to hustle, too.
They show them niggas on the news all the time.
Yeah, some of them homeless niggas going back to
jumping in their little Porsche when they have to.
When we come back, the Zoe What Morning Show turned up. We'll be back.
The essence of progression is to get to the next lesson. Because each time you progress, it's another lesson learned, climbing steps. Another lesson you learn, climbing steps. That's why I always.
I'm Laura Somoza.
I'm Sterling Gardner.
And we are Between the Sheets every Monday here, 3 p.m., tradiov.com.
TRadioV.
That's right. It's T Radio V, Radio in TV. What is that face?
She wants to see our hands.
That's Radio in TV.
Wah, 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 wah.
We're not a couple.
Hey, my fellow thoughters out there. I'm Charles Shaughnessy. Check out my new show, Here's a Thought with Charles Shaughnessy, August the 7th, 3 p.m. PST, right here on T-Radio V. Now, you know I have a lot to say, but I want to hear what you have to say. So tune in, grab your phones, call me, tweet me, email me in the studio, and let's get this conversation going. Here's a Thought, starting August the 7th, 3 p.m. PST, right here on T-Radio V. Let's radio in TV.
Hi, I'm Plastic Martyr, and I've got a new show called Just Like You on T-Radio V. It's an inside look into my Hollywood life, where I give you a sneak peek into a world of beauty, fashion, and fame. illusions will be shattered. And of course, there's a little sex, hugs, and rock and roll. Be sure to check it out Wednesdays at 11, only on T Radio V.
To a galaxy, alternate reality. I shall continue the worlds I've been to.
Hey, that's corrupt. Let it ride.
A different civilization. It feels like the aliens made it. I'm the captain of this crusade and voyage with a whole fleet that's elite.
Astral progression.
I take you to a new universe if you let me. I post with the Klingons.
It's on iTunes.
With the
Joseph Lineberg.
Telepathy, I teleport to Ecuador. I'm in the Milky Way, my nigga, just reflecting.
Hey man, this is so cold. Go support that album. Hey, listen, don't let the homie over here be the only one who donated to the VOR radio campaign. Pull up my website really quick. Not my website, but the GoFundMe campaign. We need to make a strong move here. Before the week is over, today is Monday, by this coming Friday, we should have raised $5,000. We're trying to build our own network, my friend, the VOR radio network, where the powerful platforms and shows that you guys have participated in and enjoyed, you know, shit, for the last 4 or 5 years before we left, or after we left Jamie Foxx's Foxhole Radio, where the Voice of Reason, the Corey Holcomb Show, and all of those shows existed, and then we moved on to different platforms. It's time for us to build out our own platform. So we need donations to help that reality come to fruition. Go there now, support the movement. You know you've been enjoying the shows, being enlightened, whether you agreed with us or not. You've been stimulated and motivated to do something different, so please continue to support the movement. Now, back to today's topic, Sick Society. The saga continues. Y'all got to talk to us about the homeless people that are violent. Because sometimes, sometimes homeless people will pop off.
There's some bad folks out there.
Even when you're trying to help them, motherfucker, I don't want nothing. And then you got to talk about the predator homeless dude who will prey on your sympathy, who will prey on them heartstrings and take advantage of people, and they might not actually be homeless. Right. They might be balling somewhere. Living well.
Right.
Let's speak to that. I want to start with my brother right here. What is your experience of that? Have you been able to peep when somebody has kind of infiltrated the homeless community but really is a hustler coming up on people who have sympathy for the homeless? Speak to that.
I'm down on Third and Rose, man, in Venice. It's going on 35 days now, so I've been kicking it with them. And if there's an imposter, they don't let him hang around long. He's, you know what I mean? He's out because these people want peace in their community, number one. And number two, they don't want the police coming around there.
Right.
So if it's a real community, then they're going to suss them out, and they're going to move them out, you know. And you made a comment about the ones who are mentally challenged. I get that. You know what I mean? I come down there, and sometimes you can look in their eyes, and they're gone. You know what I mean? They're gone. And it's, you know, at that time, I just kind of I say a prayer, you know what I mean, and let them tell me which way I'm going to go with them. You know what I mean? There's when I'm feeding some of the people. This one girl, she thought I touched her arm, and she spit at me, and I had to show love. You know what I mean? I had to show love, because when you out here, man, with these people, who you are is going to come out.
Speak to that.
It's like squeezing an orange. You know what I mean? Dr. Dyer talked about you can squeeze an orange 24/7, and you're gonna get orange juice. But when life squeezes you, what comes out of you? So this is one of those life squeezing moments, you know, when she spat at me, and I'm like, I mean, she ain't really spitting at me. It's tough for her out here.
Situation.
I'm like, I'm just cool. You know, here you go. Let me give you some coffee and keep it rolling, man. But it's somebody mentioned it earlier. I think you mentioned it, Thomas, when you talked about when you out there, you are learning from them.
Yeah.
When I'm out there, dude, I'm giving them food. Yeah, manna. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But they giving me so much more. Mm-hmm. And they thank me every time I come out there, but I thank them when I come out there. Because of them, you know, my metal group of brothers, Metal International, they're starting to come out there with me. You know what I mean? He's some white dudes, man.
I've been to metal. I've been to metal.
So you feel me?
I already know.
There's white dudes coming out there with me.
Like him.
Yeah. They bringing socks, you know what I mean? So what we have an opportunity, man, is bring humanity back to the table.
Right.
And it starts with us because we are love incarnated, man.
Listen, this is why I fuck with Dr. G.
Yeah, man. Dr. G is a motherfucker, man.
Listen, Dr. G, he don't know about black people.
Yeah.
He don't know at all. But Dr. G got a good heart.
Yeah.
Right. He may not be up on the culture and the subtlety and the nuance. He might even say some off-key shit. But it's because of ignorance. But his heart is right.
Yeah, yeah.
So Dr. G goes, hey, man, come down to metal. I'm like, what the fuck is metal? Yeah, you know, some people, we come together. It's all men. Is this some Fruitopian bathhouse type shit? He like, nah.
This is Fruitopian bathhouse.
Nah, I mean, because you don't know.
It's real.
But you don't know.
Yeah.
So I go down there, and I see the infrastructure. First off, you got all the women out front serving.
Yeah.
They can't come in to where the science is getting dropped.
Yeah.
Got the women out there serving donuts and shit. Taking the money.
Yeah.
So I peep the infrastructure. Like, this is the format.
Yeah, yeah.
This way. Would you like seated over here? There's the breakfast. Okay, cool. This is how it's supposed to be. You got turkey bacon.
Yeah. You got turkey bacon.
You feel what I'm saying?
Oh, man.
Then you go inside.
Yeah.
500, 600, 700 motherfuckers that are all doing something major.
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 Yeah, yeah.
CEOs, presidents, movies, industry.
Yeah.
App
development, technology.
All types of shit.
Yeah, man.
And their whole purpose is what you do. And whatever you do, how can I help you do what you do?
That's it.
I got resources for what you do.
That's awesome.
What?
Yeah.
Then the flip side of it is, but this shit ain't free. This is why I be pissed off with our community. We want a deal on everything. We don't want to pay for nothing.
Nothing.
But we want the resource and the tool to get us over singularly.
Selfishness.
So Dr. G is like, hold on. The first couple of them is free. But then afterwards, it's $50 per visit plus 100. What is it? 100
a month.
100 a month plus 50 per visit.
No, 35 per visit.
35.
Well, you got to become a member to even get to the 35. Yeah. But you ain't a member, that's
$50. Yeah. But there's so much more involved in there.
But when you get in there.
Yes, sir.
Well, yes, I just produced this movie and whoop, 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 dee whoop. Really? Well, what do you do? I'm a bootleg actor. Oh, really? Yeah, I need a break. Well, you just met a director and a producer and a casting director and some other motherfuckers that are a part of this organization. Listen, when you have those kinds of organizations in your community, do you know how exponentially harder it is to hit the bottom?
Yep. Support systems for support systems for support systems.
And this is extended beyond the border of your home, your extended family. This is an extended business resource rich family.
Yeah, yeah.
And they treat you like family.
How can I help you, Zoe? Dr. G, like 15 people. Hey, can I be on your show, Zoe? Sure. I'm there. I do this. I do that. And hey, how can we network? That's what's got to happen in the community. You tell me that isn't recycling resources? People think recycling dollars only has to do with money.
Nope.
It has to do with ideas. Contracts. It has to do with knowledge. It has to do with resources, yes, man.
Yes, Zoe.
Come on.
Zoe be hitting it, dude. Zoe on fire over this motherfucker.
I'm just trying to tell you what it is.
Right. The Metal family, when I was living in my car, I met the founder of it. Mm-hmm. And he saw my bag, and he was kind of like, that's pretty dope. So we started chopping it up. One of my homies from New York, you know, put me down with him, and he's like, why don't you come to one of the shows? And I'm, you know, I'm one of this, you know, one of the Saturday mornings. And I'm stinking, dude. I don't want, you know, I stink. You know what I mean?
I ain't
even trying to be up in there. I ain't got no money, you know what I mean? So I went there a couple of times, like you said, put my $50 out there. But this man right here, Mark, is the one that showed me crazy love and invited me to your show a long time ago, my mm-hmm. first time in there. Mm-hmm. Mark, he stepped to me and talked to me about what I'm doing and about this show. And since I, you know, stopped hiding, I was prideful because I was homeless. I didn't want anybody to know I was homeless. Mm-hmm. They taught me authenticity, you know what I mean? You know, put it out there, man. You know what I mean? You got to be authentic where you at.
Right.
Don't be walking around here like your shit don't stink.
Right.
And, you know, you put perfume on your on a pig or lipstick on a pig and your drawers all messed up. You know what I mean? You got to holler at some folks, man. Let them know. So one day, man, they had me speak. And for 10 minutes, I shared my story. And the love after that, man, that I received, the outpouring from them brothers, man, I ain't never seen.
Yeah, how do you get help if you don't let them know your situation?
Exactly. Right. So, and that Ken told me that's one of the things he wanted me to do. He wanted me to see other people who are doing well, who go home.
Yes.
Because you made a point about the homelessness thing earlier. Homeless people, all they're around are other homeless people. So how you going to, you know what I mean, how you going to elevate
change your mentality.
And do something mm-hmm. different when mm-hmm. all you are is around here? So, going to these meetings and watching people go home and I go to my car and go to sleep really helped me begin to change
your thought pattern on what they do. Mm-hmm.
And that's, listen, mm-hmm. do you know how powerful that is? That's Tony Robbins, that's Wayne Dyer, that's Iyanla Van Zandt, that's mm-hmm. that's Deepak Chopra, that's Eckhart Tolle, that's Zoe Williams.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, when you change the prevailing thought, you change the reality that you exist in. People don't understand that.
This cat right here.
People don't understand it. Now, there is a rudimentary understanding of it out there, which is linear. Mm-hmm. If I do this, I'm going to get this. Well, let me just say this. In our reality, uncertainty is built into our reality. So you don't always get exactly what you focus on. You either get a little bit more or a little bit less, and rarely do you hit it directly on the money. Uncertainty is built into our reality. But let me tell you what happens when you doubt while you're believing on something. That's when you hit below the mark because introduced fear to couple with the natural uncertainty. So fear and uncertainty come together and then you get less than what you were trying to go for. Right? Do you see? We live in an observer-based reality. Whatever the thinker thinks, the prover will prove. But so many of us are thinking with fear as a collaborative partner in the thought. Don't do that because you might not. If you do that, then this might. Just a little subtle shit. Just be right there cutting it down. Do you see what I'm saying? Dr. G, go.
I got a question for all of you. So a friend of mine, a black friend of mine.
Why you got to say that?
I got to be a black friend.
Why got to be a black friend, Doc?
I just be a friend.
I can't just be a friend?
Some of my best blacks are friends.
Some of my best blacks are friends? Wow, see? This shit is off already. See how it's, wow. I'm your best book. Blacks?
I should write a book. My years as a token white guy.
It's kind of like some of my best workers.
Okay, so listen. Black. So I'm talking to. Well, it could have been someone else. So I'll make it to someone else. But, but I was talking to someone else, and I said, you know, I think you have a right to your anger, but does it? It may work against you. And he looked at me, and he said. He said, I know it may work against me, he said, but the anger is the bracelet that holds all the pieces of me together, and if I let go of the anger, underneath it is fear and panic, so I will hold on to the anger as my bracelet that holds me together, because I don't trust enough to let go of the bracelet, because I think all the pieces of my personality will fall apart, and I won't be transformed, I'll be scattered. So I don't know if you can relate to any of that.
No, this is big. This is big. This is what people have to realize when it comes to all of that. Anger is also empowering. See, my man, Dr. Hawkins, Dr. David Hawkins.
Power versus force.
Power versus force.
Yes, sir.
Right? Get the book if you ain't got it. See, there are levels of consciousness that are beneath anger, right? On his grid, anger registers at 150, right? Neutrality is at 200. This is a grid of consciousness. The highest number is 1,000. When you're at 1,000 on the grid, your fucking body is barely able to hold in the God force.
Jesus.
But what he said was the earth is basically vibrating on 100 on his consciousness grid, which is fear. He said there's 12 motherfuckers on planet Earth that are so powerful, they vibrate at over 700 or more. Those 12 people counterbalance the other 7 billion. And actually raise the overall total of the planet to 200, which is the consciousness of neutrality.
Still low.
Still low, but at least it's neutral.
And not fear.
Right? Anger registers on Dr. David Hawking's consciousness grid at 150. But beneath anger is fear, is grief, right? It's some low shit. So imagine if you started at grief and got to anger. Sometimes anger is a motivational movement.
Yes, it
that'll
is.
Say, well, God damn it, I'm sick of this shit. I'm finna change my fucking life.
That's what happened to me.
You see what I'm saying?
That's what happened to me.
So sometimes anger gets a bad rap, but also, just like in nature, everything has a duality. There's an element of anger that could be motivative, that can motivate you to change your life when you get sick and tired of being mediocre. When you get frustrated with not giving your all, you can be angry. You have to understand, anger is born out of frustration. Frustration is created when you don't get what you think you deserve or when you don't get what you want. So sometimes anger will come to you and go, hey, man, you need to find another fucking way because this shit ain't working.
That's right.
You see what I'm saying? So. I don't mind an angry person who has now internalized the anger and turned it into motivation.
There you go.
See,
don't
this
hold
is,
it in.
This is Kobe Bryant.
Dude, I was just about to say that.
See?
Damn.
In basketball, that's Kobe Bryant is, they'll say, well, you know, a mad player makes a bad player. But what Kobe Bryant learned how to do was internalize it to his game. I'm not going to pop off on you. I'm just going to bust y'all ass for 60 tonight.
81 on your motherfucking.
I'm going to redirect it into my game. So anger can be used as a motivating factor. It takes a certain level of maturity and savvy to be able to recognize it. But once you're able to harness anger and use it as fuel, that's when you're on another level.
That's what helped me
Dr.
get off
G?
The street.
There's a we're with a bunch of coaches, so I hope this you can relate this. Sometimes when I'm working with people about the anger thing, I say there's a tip I give people. I say if you step on the accelerator when you're angry, you're going to go off the cliff. But if you downshift, you'll get traction. So when you are angry, you have a tip in your head. You go downshift, and what happens is you pull the ground into you, and you get torque. So that's force. So that's or that's power. But they find that pretty useful because they can see that if the anger you step on the pedal to the metal and you lose control, you're going to go off the cliff. So I don't know if that makes any sense to either any
of
you.
No.
To fear, just, you know, and just going to fear, fear or the etymology, the breakdown of fear is danger. But the etymology of danger is the power of a master or lord over someone.
Uh-oh.
So fear ultimately is your master or lord.
How about it?
Literally, that's the definition of it.
How about it? Your turn. Come on, jump in here, man.
Oh, I just think about when I started my shop, my business, Lowrider Shop, people were trying to run me out of business. And I'm like, man, I just told mom she can retire. You know, I need this money. You know, y'all messing with things. So then all of a sudden that I channeled that energy and ideas just started popping up. Mm. Maybe if I put rims in the beauty parlor.
Mm.
You know, maybe if I go, brothers that buy lowriders, they get their hair cut.
Mm.
So maybe I should see if I could hook up with old boy and put rims in the barbershop.
Mm.
And next thing you know, it was like all that I was losing, I was replacing even closer.
Mm.
You know, so it just changed my whole mindset. People was like, oh, don't get him mad. Don't get TJ mad, because we're going to be in trouble if you do.
Mm.
Inspired creativity.
Absolutely. Right.
Again, we live in a society that judges people based on what they've accumulated. Hmm. Now, it doesn't matter what the fuck we're doing to the planet while we're accumulating, right? It doesn't matter, right? We did a show on sustainability, and we talked about that big-ass plastic island out there in the center of the Pacific Ocean that's all washing up all the old shit we don't need no more.
Twice the size of Texas.
Twice the size of fucking Texas. Do you see the hypocrisy? We got a justice system and a political system that is built on racism. The 13th Amendment movie illustrated it perfectly.
Mm-hmm. Break it down.
Shit. Ain't no more slaves. That economy is out there. So it went from slavery to racism to laws to legislation.
Laws.
Right? We got to maintain a foothold on the necks of black people and brown people. You mean to tell me the system is engineered for you to do worse? And if it is, what makes you think you have the right because you somebody's employee to look down on somebody who don't have a job?
Employee means servant or slave. The legal definition of employee means servant or slave.
Well, I'm a servant, and I'm a slave, and I'm doing okay. I'm doing better than you. And I'm not going to give you nothing in that little dirty cup you got in your hand. Do you see the hypocrisy involved?
Somebody reached, the pastor reached out to me in View Park, where our one percenters live. Wealthiest African Americans in America live in View Park.
Which are really, in the scale of things, probably 87%. Because they're not 1%. They're not oligarchs.
No,
they could lose
exactly,
their shit.
That's right.
Right.
The motherfuckers could be right down the hill.
Right. And that's what he called me and said, man, we need help up here. He said, even though some of these people got money, they didn't train their children. And they're dying, and the children are blowing the fortune. And now you're talking about people sitting here in this 4,800-square-foot house. Pops left them $6 million, and now he's broke and going homeless. So where he was spitting on homeless last month, now that he didn't understand what that bank contract meant or that tax attorney told him, now he done lost the fortune.
Mm.
So the whole family's in the street now.
How about it?
And this is becoming the norm.
Right.
It's a journey.
Right. And let me just say, they will allow you to play the game, but they will not let you rewrite the rules. I think y'all need to understand that. They will allow you to play the game, but they will not let you rewrite the rules.
Yes, man. game. Learn the game.
Listen. The place where they adjudicate law is called a court, which is the same place they play hoop at. Okay? It's a game. There's no way you can be haughty toddy because you got a bunch of fake money. The system told you the money is not real.
It's not real. Damn it.
Nixon took the dollar off the gold standard. A new form of economics is coming into play. Bitcoins.
Yep.
You understand? Why would they allow some shit they agree with? You got fucking Bill Gates running around talking about, Bitcoin, and it's a new kind of currency. What do you mean? You got rich, wealthy motherfuckers backing a new currency, and they not a part of the government? So you mean to tell me that somebody ain't in the know on the exit of the dollar, but you got niggas running around acting like they fly to the motherfucker because they got paper? Fiat currency? Something is happening. I told people before, this woman, Hillary Clinton, is going to be the next president of the United States. I said this months ago. I said, what they're going to do is, the media is about propaganda. They're going to keep squeezing out little stories about Trump until they smack you in the face with the biggest story. I ain't never seen a GOP candidate, which is normally clean-cut motherfuckers. I mean, heirs to the throne of shit. Clean-cut motherfuckers, right? This dude, I grab him by the pussy.
Yep.
And that ain't the only shit he done said. That is just the latest in a long list of fuckery. Do you not understand that they don't let people get to that level without managing them? Every politician is a mannequin that is prepared in such a way that he articulates a point of view clearly. The point of view of the Republicans is conservatism. They got one of the most non-conservative motherfuckers in the world to represent them? This is a play.
Right.
Just like the courtroom is a game, so is politics. So if politics is a game, so is economics.
Yep.
So how you gonna sit here and feel yourself? See, life is about acquiring meaning, not things. But as long as they got you thinking you mean more because you have more, you're going to miss the whole purpose of the game because they get to rewrite the rules right underneath your ass. And that's when you come from on top of the hill to down the hill to get your reality check.
Right.
Does this make any sense? Dr. G, does it make sense to you, Whitey? I mean, Whitey Locks.
Yeah, it always makes sense to me. But I sometimes push for, okay, so what's the solution? Okay, so I hate to say it, but what's the solution? And I can be a messenger. You know, I'm a connector. I connect people, and I can get their attention. I don't belong anywhere. I get invited everywhere. I'm like, no, it's true. It's true.
That's G shit, though.
He just said it though. You have to learn the game. This show, Game of Thrones, that's been on. If you guys were watching, it is the biggest show that's ever been on in TV history. It's won more awards than any show in the history of TV. And so, when you put something out there like that, if you go and watch this, they're showing you that it is all a Game of Thrones and status. And where do you position yourself within that game? Who are you? Are you a middle class? Are you the lower class person? Are you a peasant? Are you this? And it's up to you to say who you are so the society knows how to treat you.
You know, someone once told me anyone who's against the game playing in life is someone who loses when they play it. And so the best the best defense against all the game playing in life
that's
is to play it well because they're not going away.
Wow. That's profound. Listen, and we got to take a quick break. But when we come back, Zoe's final thought to wrap this whole menagerie up. Jesus, Zena.TV. I don't know anywhere else you can find this kind of content. We're changing the world, bitches! Holla at us!
Zena.TV. here is go back.
Hi, I'm Rob Schneider.
Hey guys, what's up? This is Matt McAndrew.
Hey everyone, I'm Tyler Oakley.
And I'm Corey Cool.
Hi, I'm Martha Madison.
This is Slink Johnson, aka Black Jesus, BKA Godzilla Lungs.
Hello, I'm Aaron Roberts.
Yeah, what's up? This is Craig Wayans.
Hi, this is Brad Williams, and as you can tell, I have never gotten high.
Dang!
Speedy Don.
And I am the fabulous Stephen King.
What's good? It's your boy Marcus Park, man. We keeping it lit.
I'm Money B.
Hey, I'm John Sally.
What's up, y'all? This is Crazy Bone in the building.
It's your girl, Shantae Wayne.
It's your favorite DJ, DJ Spark.
And it's your boy, Street Symphony.
And you're watching Z.
Z.
Z Hollywood TV.
In chapter 10, we talk about the difference between being embittered, embattled, or embittered. So, if you're embittered, of course you're holding on to things. You're resentful, you're resistant. If you're embattled, you're fighting. No, I don't accept that. I don't want that. But if you're open and you're allowing the process to unfold and flower within you and beyond you, you have an opportunity to become embittered. And chapter 10 goes into detail on how to stop being embittered, how to stop looking for the win by being embattled, and how to evolve and expand to a space of embitterment. I mean, it's an incredible work, man, and I'm excited about it. So Dr. G posed a question before he left, which is solutions. I believe that economic organization, learning the game of economics from a cultural space, right, is one of the strongest tools or resources we can use to mitigate homelessness. There's a reason the Jewish population of homelessness is small. They've got infrastructure. They've got resources. Do you see how recycling black dollars and buying and pouring into black businesses and black infrastructure mitigates black homelessness? See, in our communities now, if the mentally ill visits our family, there's really no place to send them. There aren't any mental hospitals. There ain't no fucking Arkham Asylum. Ain't nowhere to go. Do you understand? There's no Arkham Asylum around this motherfucker. Right? Do you see what I'm saying? Many years ago, it was Tom Bradley down here in Los Angeles. They got rid of the fucking mental hospitals. And when they got rid of the mental hospitals, the mentally ill went right to the street, homeless. So now you have a confluence of divorcees. The number one indicator for poverty in America is divorce. The number one indicator for wealth in America is marriage. Marriage is a business. And when you get a divorce, divorce is marriage bankruptcy. Motherfuckers don't understand this. It's business. So damn. You was doing well, now you're on the street with the mentally ill. Then on top of that, domestic violence. Sometimes the domestically abused find themselves because they got to get away. Sometimes they get away without going through the system who would place them somewhere, but only for a certain amount of time. Do you see? Next thing you know, you have this confluence of people out on the street. economic organization. Black people, what are the institutions you own? Own. I don't mean seated by white folk and thus overseen by white folk and white money. I mean owned by you. We need infrastructure. We need universities. We need hospitals. We need mechanics. We need engineers. We need agriculture. Can't just let Latino Americans take over all of agriculture. Where are the black agriculturalists?
We good at it.
We need all of this. Imagine what kind of political power we would have if we had financial institutions like black banks, black universities, black farms. Do you understand what that would do? Black-owned JPL? Black-owned Jet Propulsion Laboratory.
That's right.
A black-owned Caltech? Now you're contributing to a society in a different way.
Right.
Now it's not about what can society do for you. Now society is saying, shit, how can we pay you to stay here?
Exactly.
Don't take all this shit to Africa somewhere. How can we pay you to stay here? We did, and then they dropped a bomb, first time ever. But we can't be afraid of the next bomb. We can't. We cannot be made by us. Listen, do you know how sickening it is to be in a situation to where everything you believe is good came from a system that means you no good? Krishnamurti, man, I say this all the time. It is no measure of good health to be fully integrated into a sick society. God damn. Do you know how sick you gotta be to look at the devil? To look at the devil and be like, man, this shit is better than nothing. I know this is the devil, but until you come with a better system, I'm fucking with evil. That's our people. The devil shit way better than yours, my nigga. I can't fuck with you. The devil got me.
I can't fuck with you. You're preaching love.
Do you see what I'm saying?
You're preaching love. We were taught to hate in the hood. We were taught to hate. We were taught to bang. We were taught anger. We were taught to gravitate toward it. If you're using the hands,
I'm going to hit you with them hammers.
Right.
That's what we taught, you know.
But
what I mean?
But that goes back to my point about anger. See, there's a sense of empowerment when I can let my anger off on somebody.
Yes.
That doesn't have power over me.
Yes.
Yo broke ass just like my broke ass. So I'm gonna put these dough knobs on you.
Yeah.
But you ain't gonna put the dough knobs on the system.
No.
Mm. Yeah, you see? Organization is salvation. People don't understand that. The collectivity of people coming together, working together. They got rid of Fred Hampton because he got everybody together.
Yep.
Brothers, whites, Latinos, everybody was like, hey, okay, gotta kill that nigga.
Yep.
He done got everybody together. Shit. That nigga gotta go immediately.
Right now.
not right now, but right motherfucking now. We got to get that nigga now. So, I say all of that to say, we got to come together, family. We got to support black businesses. I promote them for free, basically.
That's right.
And for the companies who reach out to me and say, how much does it cost? And I give y'all a price and y'all pay it. I respect the fuck out of you. My uncle told me black people don't respect shit they ain't gotta pay for.
Man.
No matter how fucking valuable it is,
absolutely.
If they ain't gotta pay for it, they don't respect it.
Don't respect it.
And in spite of my uncle, I believe in my people.
That's right.
And I'll be like, fuck it, I'll do it for free. You can't afford it, I'll do it for free.
That's right.
But there are some people out there that go, nigga, nah. I respect what you do.
Right.
And what you do is helping my business. Here's some bread.
That's right.
Freedom Paper Company sent me $300. That's nowhere near how much paper we helped them sell. But he gave it without me asking. Another brother from Privy Point reached out and said, how much does it cost? I told him a price. He said, I got you. Privy Point, download that shit right now. The business Swiss Army knife. Pull up that damn website. Pull it up right now. Download that brother's website. I got you. And then let me acknowledge this brother right here. Jamal Porter was the only other one after this good brother who donated to the campaign, to the GoFundMe campaign. There it is right there, Privy Point. Share, search, events, buy, discover, market, sell. Go support that brother right now. Mass downloading of this brother's app. All right? Support that man. Jamal Porter, GoFundMe, just donated $200.
So what's up, Jamal?
All right, Jamal, good looking out.
Jamal,
what's up,
Jamal?
All right,
listen, I'm Zoe Williams. That's my final thought. Ladies and gentlemen, you've been listening to the Zoe What Morning Show on Zinna.tv. That's Zinna.tv. Really quickly, Kev, where can they find you? How can they support your movement?
RealNoggas.com. We have the shirts out. Go ahead and get these new Phoenix
More. Phoenix More, my nigga!
Phoenix More shirts, please. Go ahead and knock those out. Also, if you guys are tired of being 14th Amendment slave citizens, you're tired of being being black, which is a crayon color. It's not a status. So just go ahead to...
Here go this shit.
Damn right. Stop being black. I'm going to say that till Zoe stops saying it.
Okay.
So now
show me the nigga that get through the program. I want to see that nigga.
I'm black.
Yeah, so real noggins. Huh? No, you're not.
I'm black.
But, no, you're not. No, you're not.
Go ahead,
but yeah, go to realnoggins.com. Get on status classes, RealNaggas.com. Get those status classes.
My brother.
Thomas. Website is Thomas TJ Lofton, LOFTIN.com. All the social media, same thing. Thomas TJ Lofton.
Boom. T3, stay ready. My mom used to tell me, if you stay ready, you ain't got to get ready.
Yep.
That's how we stay ready. T3, stay ready. That's Instagram. That's Facebook. That's my website. That's Twitter. All that shit.
Yo, Zoe Williams, you already know where I'm at. Follow me. Don't forget, 165 copies of this left. Go there now. We should all be able to buy this book out today. Go there now. IamZoeWilliams.com. That's it for today's show. Next week's show is going to be another heater. We're out. Deuces. Boom. So what? Holla!
Hey, man, help me out with that black shit, man.
It's to get to the next lesson. Cause each time you progress, it's another lesson learned. Climbing steps, another lesson you learn. Climbing steps, that's why I always advance and progress. I never leave the house without the eagle. I'm running over niggas like diesels. Bought a house on the moon for me and my peoples. It's just too much game that I consume to have a nigga lifted up like mushrooms. Feel like Woodstock, flowers bloom. My mind is on the moon, I walked on Mars. I never knew that I could ever get that far. I never knew that I could ever get that far. I never knew.